routine or something.
Yeah, bye. We'll just play along. We'll just see how it goes.
Yep. All right. Hello, everybody. We are officially live. I got Russell from Giant Panda King, creative director over there.
Hello, everyone. I'm just still setting up a little bit. I've had some technical difficulties here in Australia. I'm currently not at my office, so my phone is my friend, and it's not playing ball at the moment, but I'm here. Hello, Jake. How are you?
Doing well. How about yourself?
I'm all right. At some point, just because I'm on my phone, I might be asking you to repeat the question a few times because I'm just using the speaker.
Yeah. You were telling me you're going on like 3 hours of sleep because you're on tour.
Yeah, I'm currently on tour of like, because I also, apart from making books, I also make films and do stage shows. And obviously, the last 2 years of COVID, we haven't been able to do too much. But the tour picked up this weekend. So it's my first weekend. And for the last 3 weeks, I've been doing 19-hour days and traveling in between that as well. So I'm pretty spaced at the moment. So I'll try and make as much sense as I can in regards to the book.
Yeah. I have been going on considerably more sleep, so I do not envy you. But yeah, so everyone, welcome to the Gotham 1919-1939 Q&A live stream. Been kind of amping it up, had to reschedule, but here we are. And we got a bunch of your questions that you guys have left for myself and for Russell on the community posts that I've done to advertise this. So we've got a few of those, and you want to just jump right in?
Yeah, let's get you. That'll wake me up if I start actually have to use my brain.
Get the pistons firing a little bit. all right, so this one, what is Batman's relationship with the Justice League in this universe?
So originally, for those who've been with the book since the beginning, the Justice League was just this Easter egg. I was never going to explain how they fit in. I had my own internal logic, but I didn't really develop it to the point where I was ever going to answer it. You know, the original book we did, the Justice League print was for the pre-orders. It was a special thing. It wasn't actually in the first copy of the book. So that was just meant to be this like little fun Easter egg. What, you know, people did the pre-orders, could have seen what everyone else would have looked like. In saying that, since then, we've decided to do the Themyscira and the Metropolis books. So obviously Justice League does fit into that a lot more. I'm not going to go in too much because I don't want to wreck it, because those two books we'll probably get into a lot more on this discussion, I'm sure. But essentially, Justice League is put together as a response to something the Nazis do and lead up to World War II. Wonder Woman puts it together. She tries to recreate the old gods. And basically, I don't know if that came through, but my phone just went off. I'm going to put that to silent in a second after this question.
It came through on my end.
Okay, good. But basically, the way we see it is like Wonder Woman puts it together as a response to something the Nazis do. I can't really go into too much detail without giving too many story points away at this point. But she tries to recreate the gods of old Olympus. So Superman being Zeus, Batman being Hades, her being Hera, Green Lantern, Apollo, Flash, Hermes. She kind of, you know, creates these. She wants to kind of recreate that, because there are myths and legends to her as well. They're the hero stories she grew up with. So she sees that in the heroes of that generation. So she tries to put that together. Batman is the first, he's kind of like the Iron Man of my universe, my take on it. So he's the first one who comes on the scene. So he heralds in the new wave, kind of speak. He's the older one as well, even though Wonder Woman in this universe is, I think she, in my version, I think she's born just prior to the Roman Empire. But Themyscira, time works differently there, so she's not like a 2,000-year-old person. She's, I don't know, we're basing time basically, I don't know if you've ever, you know about the books, the Iliad, and the Odyssey.
Oh, yeah.
Homer. Obviously, we're basing a lot of that, our take of Amazons in real history, the same way. So, obviously, there's not much. It's more in myths and legends. So, we're going off the myths and legends were actually are there. So, time works a little bit differently in those books on those Greek islands. So, the god Calypso and Circle, they, you know, Odysseus was trapped on their islands for a period of time and he was very confused on how time worked on those islands. So, we're leaning into kind of that. But Batman definitely has the older, cooler brother mentality of the Justice League. You know, these are immature kids as far as he's concerned, amateurs. He's actually trained, if that makes sense.
That's cool.
As much as I can kind of say, I think I gave way too much away, but that's okay.
It's all right. I'm pretty sure a ton of people will forget this by the time they come out anyways, so. I'm just kidding. All right. And yeah, and I'm excited too, like, to see that take, because you see Superman form the Justice League all the time, and you see Batman do it in the Zack Snyder movies, but seeing Wonder Woman do it will be cool, I think.
Yeah, I have a very different take on the Superman-Batman dynamic. Very, very different.
Cool. Looking forward to it. It's kind of, you already answered, but will the Metropolis and Themyscira books link to the Gotham one? I think the specific phrasing was like, will there be specific moments in those books that link?
Yeah, totally. So the books are unique in the sense that they're sequel books, but they're also parallel books. So the same events happen from different perspectives. So you might see someone's take on it, and they might have a version of this person doing this type of thing, but someone else might have a different take on it. And because the books are history books, history is in the eye of the beholder, as far as who writes histories. You know, those famous lines, history is written by the winners, and there's obviously different takes on it. And I use the perfect example of, if anyone's read the latest version of Gotham, the Court of Owls is based on, you know, Bohemian Grove. And if you go into Bohemian Grove, in the 90s, there was two investigative reporters who went undercover into Bohemian Grove together. They got the same experience, but they wrote two completely different articles about it. Because one of those was a journalist who was called John Ronson, who writes a lot of books, films, makes documentaries. Amazing in-depth reporter, very left-leaning, very common sense. You have to have actual proof in order to be, you know, vetted. Now, the guy he went with, on the other hand, was Alex Jones. So you can see him seeing the same events of, like, you know, I think John Ronson reported the Bohemian Grove stuff as being quite silly and very summer camp and, you know, guys pretending to do their kind of talent show kind of thing. It had a very, that kind of feel to it, where Alex Jones thought it was satanic rituals and it was the end of the world and whatnot. But that's just a way of how you can show the same story, have two different perspectives. And we are focusing that on the book. But we're also going further. We're going to be answering questions that haven't been answered. So, you know, like Wonder Woman's title is from 1933 to 1963. So that's quite a, that's like almost 30 years more than the Batman Gotham book. And then Superman's one is 1925 to 1945. Now, the dates are meant to represent when they're active in the world. Doesn't mean that they finish after that. Like, so Bruce Wayne still exists in the other books, but he's just not as active. There'll be also things like the Suicide Squad, what's referenced in Gotham, that will go into a lot more detail in the Metropolis book.
Oh, great.
They actually find out what the mission was in Germany.
Nice. A lot of people have been looking forward to a Suicide Squad episode eventually, so, yeah.
You might have to wait a bit because that's part of the Metropolis storyline.
And I want to give you guys the full story, so I'm going to wait until those books come out probably. But
I've almost finished my research. So my research has been pretty intense. So basically the way it works and how I do my research, I'm going to give you a little bit extra insight. So I have to build the world first and know the rules of the world before I can actually start putting it to paper. Mm-hmm. So when I introduce magic and science fiction, I have to kind of figure out how they work in this world and how I'm going to present them. And once I know that, then I can finish the stories. But the research is almost done. I've basically rewritten 5 billion years of DC history.
Wow.
And I always say that, like everyone, it's a little bit hard because I love your videos, Jacob, but like when everyone sees them like that, they don't understand the full picture.
Yeah.
So you'll do one on like Robin and they'll just see the one photo of like that, the first Robin costume. And they won't get in context that it develops as the book goes on. Mm-hmm. And as you turn the page, you see the costumes get more and more like practical rather than, you know, earlier in the book, they're more, you know, fantastic, like, you know, silly. But as the violence escalates, the costumes escalate. We're doing this as well with the books. Like Batman has been on the scene. Now it's time to escalate the book. So we have magic and science fiction, but I still want to ground it. And that's where I kind of go with these characters and using that Robin example. I don't try and make it look cool straight off the bat. I make it make sense to history. So I don't change history to meet the characters. I change the characters to meet history. And it's kind of like trying to meld it together so it feels legitimate and real as much as we can. Because that's essentially the book itself, like this whole concept, is just take something that's so fantastic and make it feel like it could be real.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, you said that.
And that's essentially what we're going to try and continue with these very fantastic characters. It's it's going to be a bit of a challenge, but I think I've worked it out.
Cool. Yeah, that's something you said before too. Like, this is as much a history project / series as it is a Batman and DC project.
Probably so. More so history. But like, you know, that's the thing that makes it fun for me is that it's a jigsaw puzzle, and more so like we've gone into the philosophy of the books a little bit more for the next two. So it's a tribute to DC Comics. And all things DC, and DC Comics, like a lot of people probably don't know what DC stands for, but a lot of people probably watching your channel do, stands for Detective Comics. So I'm not going to spoon feed you everything in the books. I lay crumbs. You have to do the research outside of the books if you want the complete story.
Yeah.
Or you can just read the books and be happy with that. But those who, like yourself, who want a bit more context, I purposely left stuff out, but I left the clues in there. Mm-hmm. For you to go and do your own research and fill in the gaps, you know?
Yeah.
If I haven't got a character in there, doesn't mean they don't exist. There's enough in there to justify almost every character in the DC universe.
Yeah.
I just give you the kind of trigger points, what you have to find, or the anchor points to figure out the other characters, you know, and work it out. Like, for example, I think one of your comments, a few of them were like Polka Dot Man and so on. And because I didn't give them an answer, they made up their own take on the character.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. I'm all for that. I borrow Batman like everyone else. I don't own the character. I don't own that. I just created the world and the boundaries what people can play in, and give them enough to kind of create their own versions of certain characters and whatnot.
Yeah. And that's how
saying that, by the time we finish these three books, there's going to be probably close to 600 characters referenced in the books.
Looking forward to it. All right. Does Batman take Carrie Kelly on as a ward or just a partner?
Just a partner. It's like with those big storylines,
mm-hmm.
we just kind of give a nod to them. Like, so, you know, The Dark Knight Returns, there's enough in there to kind of, yeah, okay, well, this version would look like this.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I gave you in the Gotham, the latest version, we have some images of like the mutants and then the various gangs they splinter into, and then, you know, Carrie Kelly. But other than that, that just gives you a visual representation of what it might look like if that Frank Miller story took place. So all the main storybook beats, if I reference that, like Arkham City Games, I reference that in the latest books as well.
Yeah, that was really cool.
Yeah, so those kind of things, you know, and that also referenced the No Man's Land storyline as well, kind of thing, like as far as, you know, Arkham City and No Man's Land. So, you know, it's up to interpretation, because I'm never going to go fully into those stories because they already, a version of them already exists in the world. So you can kind of fill in the gaps yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. What are Russell's thoughts on the upcoming film, The Batman?
You know,
not really Gotham 1919 related, but I was kind of curious too. So,
listen, I think I'm a little bit fatigued of comic book projects at the moment, films. Like, after like, you know, all the streaming platforms just jamming everything down your throat every week. Don't get me wrong, I enjoy it, I consume it, but like after Book of Boba Fett and after Ghostbusters Afterlife and Peacemaker and like nostalgia, I'm kind of a bit fatigued. Doesn't mean I'm not going to watch it and excited, but when I see more, like, I'm into the Batman posts. I'm all for the film. Mm-hmm. But it's the, like, what is it? Like, Little Caesars pizzas and Batman Oreos and all that kind of stuff. It's just kind of everywhere. And it kind of kills the excitement for me a little bit when so much stuff is out there for it. But I am excited for it. I do feel like it's Nolan 2.0 a little bit from the trailers. But I'm hoping it's more like what we'll promised about in mid to early 2000s, where it feels very much, I don't know if anyone knows about the Darren Aronofsky's attempt to do a year one story.
Yep.
It reads more like that, where he was going to get a muscle car in for him and he's going to be much younger and it's going to be darker and more serial killers. So.
And then it ended up turning into Batman Begins, kind of, right?
Yeah. That was the evolution of it. So It felt more like that, what we'll promised there. And I'm open to it. I'm very open to it, but my head is being in Batman world for the last year and a half of these books and trying to get them to everybody. So The term Dark Knight and Batman is also a little bit triggering just for the next few months for me until I I only just got the last of the books out probably last week. It was a big journey, man. It was a full on thing. So I'm all for Batman, but I'm almost I just want to go in as a fan. I don't want to think about it too much. I just don't. I've stayed away from trailers. I've watched one trailer, or the Vengeance trailer. But apart from that, I'm all for it. I just want to go in as cold as possible so I can enjoy it. I don't want to put any expectation on it. That's I was going to get a drink from the fridge. One second.
Go for it.
And I am back.
Yeah, full disclosure, I did get that Little Caesars Batman
calendar. I saw you do it. That wasn't any shade at anyone doing it. It was just so much out there at the moment. That's all.
They're giving out posters too, and I forgot to grab one, so I'm a little bummed, but I'll probably just go back and ask for one.
Yeah.
Anyway. is Superman an alien in this universe?
Very much so. The fundamental things that make him a character are always going to be in there.
Yeah, because I remember you saying it was going to be a lot more akin to the original comics and cartoons.
Yeah, so the original Flash of cartoons is kind of my version of Superman, like his power level.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to remember, he's a battery. He can always charge the battery up higher. He might start off a certain way, but you might get more powerful as we go on, but you have to get the book to see that.
Yeah.
Let's just say the fall of Krypton has to be based on something. For me to make it feel real, I have to find something to attach it to. The same way I did in the Gotham, where I find things like a real person and like the Penguin, for example.
Mm-hmm.
He's set a story is essentially based on the Southside gang and Al Capone, you know?
Yeah.
Same way with Krypton and the fall of Krypton, I'm basing that on the fall of Rome.
Mm.
And Krypton itself, well, not so much Krypton, but Kendor is based on the fall of Constantinople to the Turks.
Okay.
The Ottoman Empire. So I find certain things in history, and that gives you all the detail you know to follow it.
Gotcha. That's really cool.
I can't really go into it because if I start talking about it, talking about it quite a lot, but like it's 5 billion years, guys. 5 billion years I've worked out.
It's
trying to make sense of everything. I'm talking fucking everything. I'm talking, sorry for my language. I'm Australian, I swear a lot. So try not to use certain words because I know certain words are bad in America, but here we just use them as a greeting. But the thing about DC Universe, it's so messy. Everything from the old gods to the new gods to the color spectrum of, you know, the emotional color spectrum to the crisis, multiverse, like all that stuff is so messy. And I'm just trying to bring a little bit of an order to it and streamline it and make it make sense. So everything has context and everything has an action, has a reaction. Mm-hmm. And a big part of that is to work out how Krypton got started.
You know,
who was, you know, like, why is there so few of them if they mastered, you know, intergalactic travel and all that? And give it a reason, you know, is there a Kryptonian Holocaust? Is there that kind of stuff, you know? And doesn't just happen overnight. Yeah, you could blow up the world, but that's a simple idea what people had when we didn't travel to other worlds. You know what I mean? Like, so for me, I had to kind of make it make sense. So Krypton, I'll just say this. Krypton's destruction happened 1,000 years ago.
Okay.
But prior to that, the fall of Krypton happened over a 2,000-year period.
Okay.
And the rise of Zod happened in the last 100 years. Yeah. That's all I can say. But it's like Krypton didn't happen in an instant. It was it was one of the biggest empires. Like, we go into periods of the universe, of the DC universe, and there's different times what's happened. And we're in the we're in this time now of the heroes, basically. But there's, you know, we acknowledge everything from the DC. We just make it make sense. So, you know, the old gods, the source, the emotional spectrum, you know, the presence. Anyone who, I'm saying some pretty deep cut stuff here for some people, but if you read DC and you go deep on, like, their gods and their, you know, how it all works, you'll start seeing all those characters pop up. You know, if you just Google, you know, the top most powerful characters in the DC universe, you go and we go down a rabbit hole of looking in research. But I'm making all that make sense and have context. And like this action directly affected this action, almost like there's a this fate lined out, so to speak, instead of everything being so random.
Nice. That'll be cool to see. Did you already have an extensive knowledge of Batman before creating the book, or did you have to learn a lot?
I know a lot. Yeah, I've been reading comics since I was like 6. And I'm a rabid fan of like pop culture and world building. So I've known a lot, but also I'm a massive history fan. So this just combined two of my passions, what I already was into. So it kind of was a perfect project. But in saying that, I have to research a lot. Like, I know a lot about DC, but there's some storylines what I never connected with. So now I have to connect to them. Like Court of Owls, I was never a Court of Owls fan. I did that because this fan base you put together from your videos demanded it.
Yeah.
But, you know, we, like, there's certain things like, you know, Batman's Dark Knight Metal and stuff. That, to me, they're interesting concepts as, like, storylines and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That stuff is always, I treat that like Elseworlds stuff because it's so fantastic and whatnot that it's, is it part of the main community continuity? I don't actually know if that one is or not.
Which one again specifically?
Batman Metal, or that Metal series, you know, the Batman with Laughs.
I'm kind of unclear on that too, because like it gets very like meta, and yeah, it's the ending of it. I think it's like they ended it with wanting to kick off the Future State storyline, but the Future State. It was like non-canon.
That's what I mean. It's so confusing.
Like, yeah. Comic history.
I don't know who's running the comic book industry in the States, but like,
yeah.
Don't you can fact check this. I heard it the other day and I'm going to treat it like it's a real fact. But Demon Slayer, one issue of that manga outsells the entire US comic book industry.
Which, I'm curious to know that too. Yeah. Because I know
nuts. It's
declining over here.
Well, it's also, you're getting the best version of the comic books at the cinema or on TV now.
Yeah.
In the sense that they make sense. Like, for new fans, it's daunting going in there. And that's why they do these reboots every fucking 10 years. But for me, I find it daunting to go back into comics. I do. And that, to me, I love the characters, but some of the stories is so full on. Answer to that question is I did have a lot of knowledge, and I continue to add to that knowledge, And but some storylines, I just don't know how much I want to invest in them because they're almost like an Elseworlds story to me. And unless they're affecting the character's longevity, yeah. I only graze them, so to speak. So there's always more to learn.
It's really what you have to do because yeah, there is just so much.
You can just keep adding and adding and adding.
Yeah. What was your process for writing stories, taking photographs, and designing costumes?
I've gotten the story element a bit, but I'll just recap that one quickly, and then I'll move on to the other bits. Stories is basically just finding connection. Like 2 days ago, I worked out how Cyborg Superman could fit in if I wanted to use him.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be in the 40s. Now, I never liked Cyborg Superman's origin. I always thought it was a bit, like, shoehorned in. It was a bit too easy. But I worked out a way that made sense. And once I had that, I wrote his whole page straight away. So now that's just there, ready to go. So I know what characters I'm going to have first, and then I have to research my history and work out what points I'm going to have of history. And then I need to work out what lines up between them. And once I have that connection, it's just another link in the chain. And then you have enough links, you have a book.
Cool.
Photos. I usually find aesthetics I like from actual real photos and find out what's the thing in those photos, what is the thing what I connect with, you know? Something what makes me stop on that photo rather than any others. Is it the way it's treated? Is it like the damage on it? Is it, you know, the people in it? Is it the location? Is it the lighting?
Mm-hmm.
And then I kind of start going, okay, what makes sense to the character when I'm putting in that photo? What's going to look good, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And designing the costumes, that's usually budget. Like, I'm sure a lot of people don't understand fully what kind of goes into making this stuff, but you can kind of get an idea that, you know, it's not easy. Like, there's basically 2 to 3 of us will work on this book full-time. The rest of us, all of those credits at the end, most of those people are only on set for like 10 minutes, you know, maybe an hour. There's only really 3 to 4 people in my company who make this book. I do majority of the work and my business partner does a little bit more. But logistics and budget are a big thing come into the fact playing it. Because, you know, I've said this plenty of times online, and it's not like a flex. I'm not making anyone feel sorry for me or anything. I don't make money out of these books. I spend way more on them than I actually get off them.
Yeah.
And that's what people were like. And I spent 10 years making Gotham because I wanted people to age for between photos. You know, I shot a whole bunch of photos at the start, and then I waited. And I waited and waited, and then we finished the book. And even then, like in this current second edition, because I had an extra 2.5 years up my sleeve, I went and found the kids again, who are Robins, and I let them play their older versions of themselves, you know?
That was a cool surprise to see. Like, I knew about the updated Suicide Squad photo, but I didn't realize, like, in the book, Nightwing's picture had been updated, and yeah, that was really cool to see.
And Red Hood.
Red, yeah.
Yeah, so I brought the kids back, because, you know, the kid who played Robin in the first one, he was 12 when I shot him originally, and, you know, he's 21. So that's the fun thing about it, and that's what people don't get. Like, I brought Dion back, who plays Batman.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you can see the years on his face.
Yeah.
You know, I brought Harley back. She's a little bit older, you know, and because Harley's become such a big character in those years, I know people ask about her a lot and the Joker and whatnot. And that's why I felt like I need to give her a different ending when she broke away from the Joker. That's become a big part of her storyline now.
Mm-hmm.
And we brought in the Jewish element of Harley because she's Jewish in the comics, but it's not really played upon, you know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So her fighting Nazis in World War II, I don't know if you guys noticed this, there's a little Easter egg, but she's wearing the symbol, the Star of David symbol that the Nazis put on the Jews in Poland and whatnot, leading up to World War II. She takes that and claims it and wears it as a badge of honor when she fights against the Nazis. And, you know, it's a way for her to reconnect with who she is and whatnot as well. So I'm just trying to add a few more layers to her. as well. So, but that can only happen when you actually have them aging through the book. Yeah. You feel like you're on a journey with them, so to speak. So we are spending 10 years to do that on the next two. Thank God technology has caught up with our ambition. So we're using the exact same kind of way they make Luke Skywalker seem younger in the Boba Fett episode, or really the Mandalorian episode. And the same way they make Peggy Carter in Winter Soldier look old, we're using the same way, same techniques to age our guys.
Yeah, that's a good way to, a good shortcut.
It's the only way. I don't think anyone's going to stick around for another 10 years.
Yeah. All right. It wouldn't be one of these live streams if this question didn't pop up. So
the question I get asked more than anything else, mainly, is Spider-Man part of this as a subheading by chance?
Yeah, list off any name you want from the Marvel Universe.
So, Marvel? Nah, I honestly won't. Like, I said that before, that I'm not, but I've got four more books in me, guys. That's it. Like I said, I don't make money on these books. I want to, but one day. But at the moment, like, I've got, I think we've got like just over 600 books left of this current print run. Gotcha. After that, Gotham won't be available till all three books are printed again. So Therascure is the next one. Because you got to understand, it costs a lot to make these books, but it costs a lot to print these books as well. And we're not opening pre-orders up again. I can't handle the abuse we copped during that period. Like, it was beyond our control, and we just copped so much abuse. Like, you know, and like I said, I'm working a full-time job somewhere else during COVID. You know, I'm working a 9-to-5, and then I get it, come home, plan the shoots for to add, give extra pages for no. I didn't charge anyone extra for it. I gave extra 50 pages extra. And then people who just don't understand what we're trying to do with these books, where we're trying to actually create something what lives longer than just 5 minutes. It's not content. It's something what you can pull out in 30 years and hopefully still find something hidden in there.
Yeah.
It just takes time. And books is not a growing market. It's a shrinking market. I love physical media, but it's not going to grow. So I just have to be realistic with it, and I definitely want to do more of my own original stuff as well. If you guys like what I do with other people's toys, you have to see what my original stuff, what just comes out of the noodle unfiltered. everything you like about this take on Batman is the stuff I bring into it, like, you know, the stuff I brought to it. Everything you like about that, I just double down on the original stuff. Mm-hmm. So for me, I'm more interested in building an audience through these where they can see what we're trying to do. And then when they see us do our original stuff, they'll be like, okay, this is what I was missing, you know? Yeah. There's always going to be the DC and Marvel fans out there. I am one of them. I'm always going to watch whatever Marvel puts out. I'll even watch what DC put out. Get me wrong. Everyone, I'm a DC guy. Like, I grew up on DC. My first tattoo was a DC tattoo, you know, back when I was 16, you know, my favorite character is DC. Of any comic character ever, my favorite one's DC. But, you know, they're very inconsistent with what they put out as far as films, books, you know, whatnot. And it sucks because they've got some of the best characters out there. And I just want that itch scratched, and I want to enjoy that stuff again without so much being a part of it. Yeah. So Marvel, I still enjoy their films to a degree, and I still enjoy a lot of what they're doing on with their TV shows, but like, I could easily find a million characters in Marvel to do it. It's whether the main thing stopping me is the amount of work involved, the cost involved, and also just playing with other people's stuff. You know, I kind of just want to start presenting my own things. Just so everyone knows, I said at the top of the chat, but I make films and do stage shows as well. So this year, just so everyone knows, I'm wrapping up my first feature film at the moment, which hopefully I can going to take to market in about 6 weeks. And that's a horror film, full feature film we shot during COVID lockdown, self-contained. And if anyone follows us on Giant Panda King, we'll start dropping this promo for that. I just want to get through all the Gotham stuff. we're about to scrub all our socials and you're about to start seeing new content all the time. Rather than me promoting old projects, we're going to be focusing on new stuff. We have the two books coming out this year, Themyscira and Metropolis. They'll be shot both together, and then but released separately, probably about 6 to 8 months apart. I'm not giving anyone exact that times. I'm not taking pre-orders because we don't want that. We might do pre-orders as we go to print, once the book's finished and everything. Yeah. But generally speaking, I don't really want to do pre-orders if I can help it. I'll just find the money and make the thing, and then we'll sell it when it's ready. That way everyone can get it straight away and there's no confusion with delays and everything. And I understand people are used to buying off Amazon and getting it the next day.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I'm not Amazon and I'm not in America.
Yeah.
But like, you know, I can, if anyone's interested, I can read you some of the messages. I won't shame anybody, but they're pretty brutal. And you know, I've got, you know, young women working for me and they don't need that abuse. They check my messages and they cop it and we tried our best, but it's just the world situation is still quite messed up and I think everyone's got their blinders on thinking it's easy. But that's the biggest thing. I'm a bit fatigued just by this process. Like I love doing stuff and that last 6 months wasn't fun for me. So when I'm not making money out of it and I'm copping abuse, it's just kind of, it's like, is it worth it? But in saying that, 95% of the interactions with everyone was fantastic. They were completely understand. And I, you know, I completely understand the frustration. So thank you for the people who were patient and could understand the troubles. And I understand there's a lot of dodgy people out there. And we've all been burnt by something on the internet wasn't quite overpromised. Mm-hmm. But I hope, based on the reviews and people posting about it, that we deliver, it is worth the wait. In saying that though, like, yeah, 600 books left, first in best dressed. After that, we're not gonna have books again probably till the start of next year.
Gotcha.
So anyone interested, now's the time. And this, the next printing. So the way we do our books is, they're most like, yeah, like first printing, second printing, third printing. They're all different. They all have slightly different covers, even though they're essentially the same, like picture of the Joker, mugshot, but they're different. Yeah. We want them to be kind of collector pieces. So we limit the print runs on them. They're meant to be like artwork, you know? The original prints from the first printing are always worth the most, and they cost, they're always smaller. So mm-hmm. I think the first batch of the first printing was only 500, and I think there was only 420 exist in the world. So it's like 420 books of the first print run. That's it in the whole world. So, and the stuff in there, what's not in the new books, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And well, it's always going to get better, but.
You know. Yeah. I remember stumbling across a interview you did with Kevin Smith about the book a while back. And it was one of the first times I'd heard about it other than Cult of the Batman on Instagram. So it's cool to see how much this is like kind of springboarded and become such a popular thing.
Yeah, well, I don't want a lot of people to have it. I want the right people to have it, you know?
Yeah.
It's important that people who understand what we're trying to do get it. And that's why I'll always engage with you guys on Insta. And by the way, I don't really go on Facebook that much. So if you ask me questions over there, you might have to wait a couple of weeks. I find Facebook as accessible. But I'm not on Twitter. The only kind of interaction on social I do is Insta. So if you've got questions and whatnot, it's funny. All the abuse I copped was on Facebook. Everyone on Instagram was fine. But hit us up. We're always happy to chat about it and whatnot. I'm interested in engaging like people who are into the project and into the concept and into the fandom. I never made this to be mass produced. It was always meant to be this collector's item. I think the second print run, I think we have 2,000 copies. That's it. All right. In the whole world, that'll be it. The third run will probably go bigger. Third print run on Gotham, that'll be probably 5,000. Probably do 5,000 of each book, Themyscira and Metropolis. Once that's it, there'll be none else made. That's it. So the people who get those, get those.
Yeah.
It's a collector's item. Collector's items aren't good if they're everywhere. You know? The people who follow the journey and the people who are into the book and invest the time in it are the ones who get rewarded. So in saying that, I am going to the States later this year. So we're bringing over one of my state shows. It's it's moving to the States. So they'll be touring around the States pretty much indefinitely for the next 3 years. It's not necessarily, it's a completely different thing. It's
sure
Star Wars, and it's a burlesque show, so it's a little bit rudy nudy, but it's you see more at the beach. It's not gratuitous or anything. It's more of a comedy show. Sure. But it's that'll be traveling around the States. Looks like starting in San Fran in May. But I'll be over there. I'll be doing a little bit of shooting in the States as well around that time, for this, and also for my Ghostbusters book, which will be coming out early next year. And then the final book, what we'll be doing, will be Planet of the Apes book, which I don't think I'm going to make any money out of that one at all, because those Planet of the Apes costumes. Sorry?
I might get it. You've shown me some out of it, and it looks pretty fun. So,
I reckon people get it once they know it. It's just not going to be an instant hit. You know, it's not going to be one of those things where people are going to be like, "I must have that." You know, Batman is Batman. We'll see Ghostbusters. I know there's hardcore Ghostbusters guys out there, but I make stuff what inspires me. And I love Marvel stuff, but I really like being a fan of Marvel, and I don't really want to kind of...
Yeah.
Like, you got to understand, I work in Star Wars. I work in DC Batman
mm-hmm.
with books. I work in Game of Thrones. Like, these are all my things. Tank Girl, Lady Death, like... I've even done like stage shows with Marvel stuff. Like I've made like Iron Man and War Machine costumes, movie replicas in real life, and you know all that kind of stuff. I've had like I've worked with all these at some point. I'm just coming to an end of working with other people's stuff, you know. Because I'll say it here. I don't know if it's going to happen, but this year we're trying to start our own streaming platform. So Giant Panda King, if we get it up. We've only got a working name at the moment. It's called Channel 83.
Nice.
Basically, we don't like the streaming platforms out there at the moment. It's not that we don't like them. It's just, well, I just said we don't like them, so I'm going to stick to it. But I was trying to be nice after I said that. But it's just, they don't inspire me. They feel like I'm going into an interface and, you know, platforms. That doesn't inspire you. Like, some of your audience might not remember this, but... How old are you again?
I'm going to be 25 in May.
Oh, yeah, you would have probably gone to a video store when you were younger.
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember?
Yeah. I watched Blockbuster and Family Video close down.
Yeah, so that's the thing. But when I used to be a kid, I used to walk through the aisles and look at all the artwork, you know, of all the covers, and you'd wait for something to kind of grab you, like, you know, something to speak to you, what you're in the mood. It was a very personal experience because you used to curate what you wanted based on everything out there. And they presented it so beautifully. Like, you could look at that, or go into the cinema and seeing, like, the poster in the foyer for a film that's not going to come out for another year. Like, Jurassic Park posters were in there a year and a half before that came out, you know, got released. So the anticipation you got from that was incredible. But now everything's at our fingertips and curated. Not curated anymore. It's curated by an algorithm, you know. And to me, an algorithm doesn't really make sense, like, to curate for somebody. Like when I was, the traditional way of telling stories is from one generation to the next generation, and each generation adds their own little take and spin on it, you know? Yeah. And that's how the stories develop over time. But that comes with, like, you know, everyone's got like a cool older brother or like an older friend or someone who introduces them to stuff, you know? Yeah. Like I used to go to the record shop and I'd go in there and go get, you know, something like, I want The Offspring. And then you get The Offspring, and they're like, "Oh, cool." Then you, next time you go, "Oh, you should really check out, if you like them, you should check out The Ramones." "Oh, cool, I'll check out The Ramones." "Oh, you like them, you should check out Iggy Pop." You know? And then you start going back and forth. Sorry, I've got about a million people texting me. but that's the whole point. You get introduced to these new concepts and ideas and everything through other people. And the way I see an algorithm, and I might be oversimplifying this, and I'm sure some people who are into programming are going to probably crucify me or that I don't know what I'm talking about. But my feeling is, with algorithms, is it's essentially like eating, you know, you pick something what you like to eat. You go to a buffet and there's all this food, and you go there and you're like, "Oh, you know what, I feel like some ice cream." So they go, "Oh, great." And you go back there the next day, and now you've got 50 flavors of ice cream. You know, I do like ice cream. I guess I'll try another one. And you go and you pick, you know, that scoop, which is a different flavor. And then the next day you go back and now you've only got like 15 variations of that ice cream in that flavor. You know, they just keep giving you more of what you've already kind of consumed. Yeah. You know, they're doubling down on what you're into by saying, oh, you like that? You'll like this. Instead of trying to challenge you or evolve you, which is what curation's meant to do. It's meant to take you from where you are here and take you over here in your journey. And like in at my company, content is an evil word. We don't make content. Content's disposable. I don't want to make disposable stuff. You know, that's my biggest thing. And there's plenty of content out there. TikTok gets, you know, I think there's this ridiculous statistic, but I think every day more media gets uploaded to TikTok or something like that than what was created in the first 60 years of like film or TV or whatever. It's ridiculous. We're just making stuff, and it loses effect. Like when you have that endless scroll on, you know, TikToks and YouTube stories and all that kind of crap, you become desensitized to it. Mm-hmm. And I want to kind of create these real experiences, like going to a video store. Now, you can't recreate the actual experience, but you can recreate the feeling you had and the control you had and inspiration you had by changing a few things. How do we take that and put it, that kind of energy, onto the screen experience? And that's what we're interested in doing. So that's, long story short, what was the question I used? Marvel project. Okay, I'm getting there. I'll wrap it around. Just stay with me. I'll wrap it around. basically, long story short is, no, I'm not going to be doing a Marvel project. It's not because I don't want to. It's just because there's so many more elements into it and you need to have that dedication. But that doesn't stop any of you guys doing a Marvel project. Think of a different idea. Do your take on it. Like, my job as a creator is to inspire other people to either, get into the world, the books, or if they want to create themselves, they can see what we did and do their own take on it. Hence, Batfeed is a perfect example. He liked the book so much. He wanted to do a review. We never had a review, so I said, fine. And then he wanted to do something different, which was he wanted to present the review as, you know, a true crime thing, documentary. And that made sense to me in the world. That would make sense that someone would, like, you just have to go onto YouTube and look at all those people trying to build up a true life, a true crime, like, and like, you know, all those murder channels and shit like that. Like, it's so bizarre. Like, there's so many of them and they just keep telling the same stories over and over again. I think I must have heard, you know, some of those crime stories like 50 times over, just from different people. And it's great, but like, there's no shortage of it for me. So when you kind of took the concept of what I created, but then I might, you know, do it in the context of a history book, but you've taken it and did it in the context of a YouTube style true crime documentary series. Mm-hmm. And it feels legitimate because you are a YouTuber trying to do it with the resources you have. You know, so like I say to some people sometimes, like, the only thing, Jacob, I do agree with this. The only time I've ever cringed at one of your videos is when you recreated those interviews and you put the voice on. That's the only time. But everything else,
again, since so,
everything else, you've done really good to make the world feel like that. And that's what I say to other people. If I'm not giving you it, if you want it to exist, do it. It's that simple. And you don't have to do it as a book. You can do it as a YouTube video. You can do it as a cosplay. Like, you know, if you really want to see a character, design it, make the costume, take a photo of it, send it to us. We'll post it.
Yeah. I've had so many people reach out to me and be like, well, here's this idea, concept, script, whatever, that I came up with for a 1960s Spider-Man thing. And I'm like, great, run with it. Yeah.
As I say to anyone, like, people come up and go, how do I get your job? I'm like, create it. You don't, no one's going to hand you a dream job. You know, that's when you're dreaming. If you think you're going to get that handed to you, you have to just make it. You know, that's the thing. If you want something to exist and it doesn't, you're the key in that actually happening.
Yeah. Cool. On to the next question.
Yeah, sorry about that Marvel one. I don't know.
You know what happens? That's why we do it live. That's less to edit later. What inspired you to write Gotham 1919 to 1939? I know a lot of people have been asking this one, so I just kind of grouped it together into this question. But
yeah, honestly, I don't even know. It's such a long process.
And yeah.
It's evolved so much. It's not like a light switch going off. It's like you collect all this information and you have like little ideas for years and years and years, and then it starts coming to the forefront. Like, I don't think there's any shortage of anyone who follows me. They would have seen the book concept started out very different. It's a stage show, which the Batman Follies of 1929, which is going to be funny because I'm going to be releasing that soon in a very interesting way. That stage show, film of that. It hasn't been, I haven't even seen the footage in, you know, 9 years. Last time I did it. But essentially, once I went down the path, it really started locking in so quickly. Everything just started locking in. I was like, oh, that makes sense. Oh, that makes sense. Oh, makes sense. And it's like a jigsaw coming together. And obviously, when you start a jigsaw, you've got all these pieces and they're all spread out. And then you start putting bits together, and you start creating a bigger piece, and then a bigger piece, and this piece over here. And then they all start coming. Then you finally have the full picture. But you can't see the full picture until you start. And that's the biggest thing, is that you need to start down that path. And even if it doesn't work and you hit dead ends, you just have to keep working on it. But a direct inspiration, I couldn't tell you one thing. Like, I'll tell you a few things about what inspired some of the aesthetics of the book and some of the style and everything. So that format of the wide shot, the close-up, and the little kind of biography, that's a pretty stock standard one, but I took that exact kind of page layout style from a behind the scenes book of a film called Nightbreed, which went over all the background characters, and these characters were tiny in the background, but the makeup was amazing on them at the time. So they created a whole book, Nightbreed, and that's how they laid it out. And they wrote all these backgrounds for all the characters who didn't even have, they're on screen for like a second. That was really good. And then there was also Kingdom Come back in the day. If you ever bought the hardcover slipcase like I did and spent a lot of money on that, you got a special black bounded leather book, what you pull out, and it was called Revelations. And that had all Alex Ross's sketches. It was his sketchbook.
Nice.
And then he had all the character biographies of everybody. And unless you had that book, no, it wasn't even that book, actually. But that book gave you a lot of background information on all the characters who didn't have any speaking roles or anything. So that's how I know so much about Kingdom Come.
Yeah.
But also, I got the Kingdom Come collectible cards at the time. And on the back of one of the cards, I don't even know, because he's not even in Kingdom Come, but they reference him on the other place they reference him is on the back of this collector card. And it was Tim Drake. And he joins the CIA. In Kingdom Come. But they didn't mention that anywhere in the books or anything. It's just on this trading card. That's the only thing.
Mentioned that.
Reference.
Yeah.
But I took that and I had that in the back of my head going, I like that. Like the skills he learned from Batman, he actually went into law enforcement and, but for me, he was always the detective, Tim Drake. So I thought he'd be better. And then when, you watch something like X-Files or Mindhunter, where you have that kind of agent who's a little bit obscure and weird and, savant. That's where I start seeing Tim Drake in my head, And that's when I, that's just an example of like a little jigsaw piece. And then I build another jigsaw piece and then another. And then eventually they all come together. So it's kind of hard to explain one thing. It's just a whole bunch of different stuff. So yeah, the Nightbreed was like that kind of flow, but also, exactly Tim Drake from the back of the trading card. There's all these tiny little threads and story points, and I like how it wasn't from one source. Like, for example, I don't mention Black Canary in Gotham 1939.
Yeah.
But I do. I'm just not going to tell you how. You have to do the research, Like,
yeah.
That one's an easy Easter egg. Now I've mentioned it. You'll probably find that if you haven't already. Have you found it?
I have not. I've been actually meaning to sit down and do an extensive look through to look for all the Easter eggs.
I'll tell some other people if they get stuck. But I'm not telling the guy who has Batfeed for his channel. He has to do the research. but yeah, so that, it just comes from everywhere. one more thing with the references, but the photography style, it's based on a very particular book. It's called, there's a few different photographers what I based it on and different styles, but there's a book called City of Shadows. It's a book created from the mugshots from the 1920s of Sydney. Sydney's like an area in Sydney in the 1920s was called Razorhurst. It was five different suburbs where we didn't, like, guns became illegal in Australia in 1906. So basically what all the criminals used to do was carry around a straight razor, and they used to form these what you called razor gangs.
Yeah, the razor wars.
Yeah, we had the razor wars. The razor wars lasted for about 7 years. And like 1 year alone, it was like 500 people went to hospital with razor slashings. Because the thing what they used to do was the L cut, and the L cut is disfigures you horribly. These big guys became like surgeons. They became masters. They'll walk up, straight razor out, come down here, flick out the chick. So you have a scar up here, and it'll open up all your face as well. Yeah, it would sever all your nerves, so you'd go paralyzed in one face, side of your face and all that. Yeah. Very nasty stuff. I just like telling that story. I digress a little bit. But that book is... they didn't know how to take photos. You know, they're learning. So they're taking these beautiful photos. And if anyone just looks up City of Shadows, and there's the sequel book, which goes into the story of the people. Like the first book, City of Shadows, is just the photos. But everyone wanted to know who the people in the photos were. So he released the second book, which I like, but it takes away some of the mystery because I made up all the stories when I looked at the first book. And if you just Google those, you'll see the images pop up. And those images have been stolen quite a lot of Hollywood. Let's just say Pinky Blinders has stolen a lot of that aesthetic. So the Pinky Blinders aesthetic is more based, I reckon, on the Australian in the 1920s rather than Birmingham, but it's all right. Yeah, so it's just, yeah, it's not one thing what inspires you. It's a whole bunch of different stuff. You know, it's not a switch that goes off. It takes time. It's like boiling water or cooking a meal. It's not just one ingredient, it's many.
Yeah, that's, I mean, as a graphic designer, that's kind of how it is for us too. You know, you make a mood board when you're starting a project, and it's not any one thing. It's just like you're trying to find what aesthetic overall you're
looking. That's exactly right. But even go earlier to that, before you even start the mood board, it's coming up with the idea, and it's just that even that, like, I come up with ideas all the time, that's my job, but a complete idea, what has room to grow, evolve, work across multiple formats, stage show, film, you know, books, all that kind of stuff. And then also stand up to a community which can be highly critical of stuff they love. Because you've got a duty of care when you take on other people's content, you know? Yeah, I chose Batman because I thought they'd find an audience very quickly. You know, I'm sure a lot of people like playing with this stuff because they love it, but they also know there's another lot of people. And if you're going to try and hijack the audience, and I say that very lovingly because I do it, but if you're going to try and hijack the audience, you got to make it worth it, you know? And I said, I'm currently working on a project. I don't want to tell you too much because it's... but I'm currently working on a project which is going to go along with the books. I haven't even told you that much. I think I told you, maybe mentioned it once in a conversation on it and stuff. But basically, I want to create the best DC collectible ever created.
Yeah.
It's going to be high end. I don't want, same way with contents, a dirty word for me, same as Funko Pop. I'm not saying, there's no shade at Funko Pop. I don't get it. I don't know why it's so popular. They all look the same. Like, I don't get it. But that's for plenty of people don't get what I'm into either. So that's everyone, each to their own. But the thing I want to create is something high end, something what can last. Like, someone pulls out in 100 years and go, oh, my, we got this. This is like, you know, like, I'm trying to be very careful with my wording here. So I don't want to go into it too much because expectation's going to be. I can guarantee that 95% of the audience won't be able to afford this thing I'm creating. I'm going to be honest. It's high end. It's super, super limited. I'm only going to be making about 50 of them, if that. But the thing is, everyone's going to get a chance to see them and play with them. I'm just trying to work out how to say this without giving the ideas away. So next year, once I finish both books at the end of the year, I'm looking at doing a book tour of the US. I'm going to come over with the books and this thing I'm working on. And we're going to just go on a road trip, and I'll go to comic book shops, I'll go to bookstores, I'll go to comic conventions around the US. So we'll come to you.
No.
So if you don't ever want to buy, this will be the 5,000 books, and I'm only going to do it till I sell out of the books. And then if I sell out of the books, then I won't be continuing the tour. Unless, you know, because, you know, but the easiest way if you want a book is as soon as I announce it, order it. I give you plenty of run-up. I'll give you plenty of month's notice. But, yeah, after the fact, don't come and ask for the book. Like, everyone's asking me for, I think I get about 10 messages a week for people who want a copy of the first printing.
Mm-hmm.
You just don't have them. I don't even have a copy. Like, yeah. I gave one away ages ago to someone. He think I would reprint it, but we didn't. I did find a box the other day with four. So I think I've got four copies of the original book left. Oh, wow. I don't know if I'll just keep those probably for their prosperity. But,
yeah.
Essentially, these aren't meant to last. So, you know, everything we do on these, it's a period of time. And the people on the journey right now, I'm going to give you as much as I can of this world over the next 2 years. But after that, it doesn't exist except on your bookshelf.
Yep. Yeah, the only way you'll probably be able to get it is secondhand, if anyone's even willing to part with it.
Exactly. Like I said, like, these are the experiences these days what we don't have anymore. There's limitations back, you know. Yeah. I remember one time I wanted to see a film so badly. I couldn't get access to it, like, in the late 90s. Like, you know, it's not like now. This is when I was a teenager, obviously. But I wanted to see Six String Samurai ever since I saw the promo for it in a comic book magazine.
Mm-hmm.
But no one was presenting Six String Samurai. It never came to Australia. It never was released in Australia. And it took me 8 years to track down that film.
Nice.
And was I disappointed? Yes, I was disappointed. But that's not part of it. I invented the film in my head over those 8 years. And yeah. So it was fun with it. My goal is try not to disappoint you guys. But the journey is part of the experience. Like the anticipation. Like it does, like it cost me an extra $3 to put the packaging together on those books per book. I could just pocket that money and whatnot, but I want to create a better experience for people. So I'm not trying to sound like I'm flexing or bragging that I'm, you know, with all this kind of stuff, but I just want to get it across to people. The what we're trying to do is more than just a book, you know, and that's why I decided I'm not going to sell anywhere else but our shop, because I want to control all the aspects, the way you get it, the way you open it, you know, those kind of things. Create excitement. I used to love getting, when I'd order stuff from, because back in the day, mail order, you used to get the magazines and the promo all in magazines or comic books. Then you'd write in, send your check, what you wanted, and it'd get sent back to you. Then the internet got invented and it changed everything. But we want to kind of, the anticipation was part of it, waiting, the excitement. Like all those people hated waiting, but the excitement they had when it arrived. Now, I wanted to match them and give them something to be excited about. That's why we did the brown paper bag and the wax seals, to make it interesting.
It's so cool. It's such it makes it an experience when it finally does arrive, yeah.
Exactly. I want to feel like, you know, it is something from that period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm skipping a few here. Sorry for anybody whose questions we don't get to, but we're short on time. For the rest,
I'm talking a bit too much. I'll shorten the answers.
Don't worry about it. I figured we probably wouldn't get to all of them, but will the Justice Society show up in the other books? People were naming names like Wildcat, and I know he shows up in the second edition.
Yes,
people like that. Yeah.
Yes.
There you go.
Just a long story short, I'll just say this: in the next two books alone, there's almost 500 characters.
Yeah.
So no one has said anything what's not in the book so far in any of the comments.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty much everyone is in there.
Yeah. How was the Batmobile created for the book? I know the answer to this, but people are still asking.
Well, you do it. You can answer this one.
Okay.
I'm just going to plug in my power while you answer that, all right? Just to charge my my phone because I'm chewing through my battery.
Yeah. So what they did was they created a miniature scale Batmobile that they wanted with the aesthetic and the design that's already existing in the book. And then they photographed that. So somebody somewhere in one of the community posts asked, is this a scale model? No, it's not. It's a smaller one, but it's still...
Yeah, so basically, the car we used as a reference for that is, it was only a concept car. They only made...
Gotcha.
I think they made like 30 of them back in the day. But those, so we found that we made a smaller model. Exactly what Jake said from there on. But yeah, it's just finding the right thing that felt right. And that fin on the back, I added that. You can't see it in the photo too clear because it's so dark. But like he actually has the bat head battering ram.
Oh, nice.
And it's the same thing. Like I wish I could show you photos. I'm not going to do it because I don't want to wreck the illusion. But the photos of how much detail we put in the Batmobile and the Batwing plane.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we built them from scratch, and then the photos kind of look fake, like, especially the Batwing. Like, the Batwing kind of looks fake. The problem is, if you Google that type of airplane from that period, it looks exactly like that flying.
Yeah.
It's just... it's weird. Real things look fake. It's
so crisp and clear nowadays, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And you've got context.
Oh, yeah, yeah. This one I figured would be a fun one to cover, but someone was asking what inspired the Riddler's story.
There's a few things. Like, you know, the obvious one is what, you know, Matt Reeves is quoting, which is the Zodiac. I think everyone understands that. Zodiac is definitely a Riddler type. My Riddler's a little bit different. I imagine somebody who leads this perfect life, like with no questions asked, so to speak. In my version, I don't really kind of allude to it, but I always pictured him as homosexual, but like repressed. His take is definitely inspired by the, what are they called? The Leopold and,
Loeb.
Yeah. That case, just points. Like I just sprinkled their story throughout it. Like their stories. They're not very smart, those guys. They thought they were. That was the whole point. It's more the mindset. But what if someone's actually successful? But then, like, Hannibal Lecter type as well. You know,
yeah.
Definitely
yeah.
At the end of Gotham, where you have that, where we talk about Tim and the Riddler, because Tim's trying to actively solve these serial killers that are popping up, cases. So the only person who kind of fit the brief, and Tim basically invents profiling out of that.
Yeah.
And then he goes and joins the FBI. With that new knowledge, but he has that very weird role. He kind of, in my head, if this was a TV show, which I always write these stories as if they're a TV show, like I see this as a six season TV show Gotham, and characters come in and leave. Not like Titans, where you know one episode he's Robin, next episode he's Red Hood. I mean, like it's told over a period of time. You get to know the characters, they leave, the stakes, and. At that period, Batman's disappeared from Gotham and no one knows where he is. And I would have him gone for at least a whole season where you don't see Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
So you actually have that feeling, what they're feeling, the characters. Where is he? What's he doing? You know? And I see Tim almost treating the Riddler as a mentor at that period. And the Riddler enjoys this and starts playing with Tim, like headspace and messing with him and all that. And again, if you want that story, you can go and watch Silence of the Lambs or Mindhunter and just project those characters onto the characters you're watching. But the Riddler, for me, he's very intelligent, very bored, and has no real emotion. And I suppose a good example is the Sandman Mystery Theater. A lot of the villains in that are a good example of how you can twist them. Exactly. That's a big inspiration for Gotham. If anyone's interested, that was a very big inspiration for Gotham. It's just grounding the Golden Age kind of thing. It's a much smaller world than what I try to do, but I'd be lying if I said that wasn't a major inspiration. So you should check out that one. But yeah, the Riddler is just intrigues me, but I don't want a knockoff of the Joker. That's never the Riddler for me.
Yeah. Yeah, you see that so much.
Oh, like, totally. It's
try to re-zany the character and that he ends up becoming like manic or crazed or something. It's like,
yeah. Have you ever seen Hannibal, the TV show Hannibal?
I have. Yeah. Yeah.
He's great in that, you know, because you just think he's helping the police. He's charming. He's eloquent. You wouldn't suspect that unless they showed you it, you know. But that's what I see the Riddler as. He comes into work. He remembers his assistant's birthday. He buys her a present and all that. But no one knows what he does on the weekends.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of fascination around the Dark Knight Returns aspect of the epilogue.
I knew there would be.
Yeah. Is there a section about Batman's battle with the Mutant King in the book? You kind of partially answered this already earlier.
There is, but, you know, like I said, you have to, you fill in the gaps.
Yeah, exactly.
Part of the process.
Who was the hardest character to write about? Or, like, the hardest character, I guess.
Honestly, it's the characters who don't give me, like, their rehash of other characters, like, because as I've said this in previous chats we've done, the characters are hard because when you put them side by side, you realize how similar they all are. A lot of them, anyway. Like, Hush's story is very, very similar to Black Mask when you boil it down, you know, in the comic books. You know, they're both from, like, families with names and both hate the Waynes and da-da-da-da-da. One becomes Black Mask, one becomes Hush. Hush was very hard for me because I was trying to add something new in there. And I don't fully feel like I've nailed him fully because he's such a big, smart dude in the comics and everything, but he's such a ridiculous character when you really look at it. He's wearing bandages all the time, but he's a fucking doctor. Like, I don't get it. Like, it doesn't make sense rolling bandages on and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, I try to think of a way that he was so smart that no one knows he even exists, kind of thing. And I don't know if I fully nailed that, but he's been around as long as Batman, but he's smarter than Batman, if that makes sense. And I don't know if I've got that across quite yet, but his whole point is that he's only known when he wants to be known. He's pulling the strings, and he's a new type of criminal. He's not the Court of Owls. He sees those as like hicks, you know what I mean? He's the type of criminal for a new generation. I see him as like a Lex Luthor type, honestly, but staying in the shadows. He's not an extrovert. He's an introvert.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to doing an episode on him down the road somewhere.
Yeah, I might add to him somewhere. I don't think I'll add to him in the books, but it'll make sense when I announce this other thing. It's so hard to try and talk about this other thing because I really want to. It's very exciting. But if I do, I know I'm going to be fielding questions from Lux for a year. All right, Lux, because I know you're watching.
Asking the questions nobody thinks of so that we can all fill in the blanks a little bit.
There's no shade at Lux. We actually appreciate the conversations.
It's a lot of fun. What were your sources for the period costume design? I mean, you can pretty much just look up 1920s.
Yeah, honestly, you can, but also you got to realize that the world was a different place. Like, for example, Australia's fashion was probably 8 years behind New York and London. You know, European aesthetics are different to US aesthetics. What's appropriate for the time? And I know you've run into this with your ill-fated Josephine Baker.
That was rough.
But yeah, you just have to, you have to do the research and like work your way backwards.
Yeah,
I'm not. Do you want to tell that story? I just made a joke, but when you as soon as you put it up.
Yeah, we did the Arkham episode way back. I think that was like the third
one.
And I needed a picture of a vaudeville dancer for the ventriloquist's mother, and I'm looking through, and there was this unlabeled one that I grabbed. Just kind of, I was in a hurry to find it. And we post the video and everyone's like, oh, that's Josephine Baker. I didn't realize that she was the ventriloquist's mother. And I was just like, shit.
I just laugh. I'm like,
Yeah.
I think I must have been one of the first ones in messaging game. So Jesse Baker's black, right? Just like the most famous black vaudeville dancer ever.
It was pretty rough. So like when we made the full episode of season one that was like almost 3 hours long, we swapped the pictures out to fix it, but you know, the original video still has it there.
Yeah. So the thing is, yes, Google's your friend, but you have to also do background checks on the images you find as well, and references and stuff. Because, you know, I like doing things in secret as well. Like, I don't know if you noticed this, you probably won't, this is a super deep cut. But like, for example, there's the languages of the street during leading up to World War II in the 1930s in Germany, for example. So there's a lot of prostitution. And it was illegal. So what they did was, in certain areas anyway, they'll dress in certain ways. So they will tell you everything about you, their advertisement. So if you wore yellow laces, it was a certain type of thing. If you wore a lace collar, it was another type of thing. So, you know, so getting to know that stuff and going deep and then putting that stuff in there and not telling anybody. And then one day someone might know the reference. Is the thing I love. I do a lot of work hoping that one person will find it, but there's plenty of people who haven't found hardly any of the Easter eggs. I haven't heard any of the deep cuts come through yet at all.
This one's pretty obvious. The Batman Beyond poster with like
that's not a deep
as Batman was like a little nod there.
Well, how many people asked me in that first, when the book went out, is Batman Beyond in this universe, Terry McGinnis? I'm like, by putting him in this book, you'll take away from what the book's about, essentially.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I figured I'd give him Terry McGinnis, but in a certain way.
Right.
Did you get the Easter eggs in that poster, though?
A few of them. Yeah, there was that one.
I'm going to test you here. I'm putting you on the spot, Mr. Batfeed. What are the Easter eggs in that poster?
I was just about to say, off the top of my head, I remember looking at them and figuring them out, but I've forgotten them since. Because it was back when you sent me that image the first time before the books were even out. So,
You disappoint me. You disappoint me. Yeah. No, it's I'll give you one.
Watch my back.
I'll give you one. So the film, they say, from the makers of Dreadcastle, that film in the Batman lore is the film that Clayface was in.
Yeah.
And the director is the guy who Clayface tried to kill in his first appearance in the comics.
Gotcha.
Yeah, so there's heaps of stuff like that. I'll just give you that example to the audience so they know that everything is something. Nothing's in there by accident. Nothing's made up. Everything's in there to either plant a seed or to give you a bit of, like, fun fandom stuff.
Yeah. Nice. And then this is, I think, the last one, and then we can probably wrap up. If you had to choose any other time frame for this project, like time period, what would you choose? Which I remember a similar question in the past, and you were like, well, we went with this one, so.
One sec. What was that question?
If you had to choose any other time...
Oh, I've lost my audio. One sec. One sec. Sorry.
You're fine.
God damn it. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, yeah.
All right, well, I'll answer this while I'm trying to figure out what... if you can hear me, I'll answer this while I'm trying to figure out how to get you back on. But if I had to choose any other time... The thing is... I'm already doing it. You'll see it in the next two books. It's not all set. You know, it's like that's the period it's set in, but we reference a lot of stuff beforehand, and reference some other stuff. This one's a tricky one for me. But basically, the Old West is always great. Medieval stuff. I always like the turn of like humanity. Like so, when like the Babylonians and all that kind of stuff.
Civilization.
Yeah. So basically, I am doing those other time periods, or at least referencing them in the two new books. So you'll see that. I haven't fixed your mic yet. I'm trying to See if I can help with this.
Sure.
Okay, I can't hear you, but do you want to put up one more question? I'm happy to do one more question, and then I'll probably have to bounce. But I will just have to read off the screen because something has happened, and I have no idea how to get your audio back.
You're fine. Here's another one.
Okay. I generally don't sign things just because value the story. Don't value the creators with this stuff. All right. Like I really, you'll notice me. I don't have much of a presence anywhere online. I don't really do socials that much. Like you look at our followers, like I went on the Instagram again. I joined Instagram again, a personal account 3 weeks ago. My business partner, Craig, you'd be lucky to find a photo of him out there. we don't really do it for that kind of stuff. So like signing stuff, I don't really do it, but say if I was at a book thing and someone asked, I won't say no. I just won't offer it. Like, it's not like you can order it signed or anything. It's just, I'm sorry. I just find that stuff for me personally, it's just not who I am. And I'm more happy about chatting with people, getting photos with people. If you're after a real experience with me and you, I'm all for that. But for like sign stuff and that, it just makes me feel very fake and unauthentic. So, yeah, I have no idea how to get your sound back, man. So I think that's a good point to stop. Can we just wrap it up with a thumbs up with each
other? Do that. I don't want to say thank you, everyone, for joining. Thanks for taking the time to watch this. And Russell can't hear.
I'm assuming you're just talking to the audience because I can't hear.
Yeah. Yep. thank you to Russell, even though he can't hear us, for joining in too. So we'll just do a 3, 2, 1.
Thank you. Thanks everyone for joining in. And we'll do this again in a few more months if we sell the rest of the books and we have new fans and it's justified if anyone's got questions.
Yeah.
Other than that, thanks Batfeed for hosting this and continue what you're doing and all the people who support us with the books and were patient. Thank you very much. Those people who didn't, you don't need to buy from us anymore. We're fine. But anyone who's a genuine fan and who wants to be a part of this unique journey we're going to be doing over the next 18 months, love to have you involved. We're a small club of Batman fans for this project, but we're a potent one. So thanks everyone, thanks Batfeed, and we'll do this again soon.
Yeah, all right, thank you guys so much and have a good rest of your day. Peace out. Oh, and remember, the night is always darkest before the dawn, and I promise you, the dawn is coming.